90.3 WHPC now presents Law You Should Know. The law affects every aspect of our lives, our home, our jobs, and our recreational activities. Now, learn about the law and how to protect yourself against the loss of your liberty or property, and learn how to stand up for your rights and seek compensation when you have been wronged. Your host for Law You Should Know is attorney Kenneth J. Landau, a past dean of the Nassau Academy of Law, and frequently lectures to lawyers on ethics and avoiding problems with clients, and to the public on how to choose and use lawyers. This is Law You Should Know on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Hi, this is Ken Landau, and welcome to Law You Should Know. Today we'll be talking with Judith Fine. She's a culture adventurer, and she tries to promote a cultural tourism where lawyers and others can use their skills and their talents and their ambitions to help people in a world away, and perhaps share and bring them to a better place. Judith, welcome to Law You Should Know.
Hi, Ken. Good to be here.
You've taken many global adventures, but aside from wanting to see the sights of the world, you wanted to take a tour with impact, where you could have an impact on the place you were visiting, and it would be a lasting connection with them. I know that you spent some time in one of those adventures that others might be able to continue or follow in your footsteps is visiting a prison. Tell us briefly about your adventure and how you were able to help prisoners in a foreign country.
Ken, I don't know that I'm able to help them. I think they help me. That's what I think the listeners would be very interested in hearing. It opens your heart. It blows open your heart. It makes everything possible. So I'll tell you how this happened. For 6 years, I live in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And for 6 years, I volunteered in a juvenile detention center. And the results were not very good. There was a very high recidivism rate. The kids were always afraid. It was pretty confrontational and violent. And when I went to Mexico, I'm a travel journalist, an international travel journalist, and I went a little early. I was teaching a class training people to be travel journalists, and I went to visit a prison because I was so interested. I volunteer in one. Let's see what it's like in Mexico that has the reputation for having the most horrible prisons in the world. I went into the prison, met the director, and it absolutely blew me away. It was run like a village. This was a medium security prison in Mexico, a lot of very serious offenders, but it was run like a village. The director of the facility walked around in shirt sleeves. They had a pet coatimundi, an animal.
If you can tell me a little bit about how you were able to help the prisoners and how they were able to help you.
Okay. So the first thing I did was I said, what are the prisoners doing? What are their families doing for money? And they said to me, well, a lot of them are making things. They make hammocks. They make furniture. They make art. I said, wow, is this facility open? Is it open to the public? And they said, yes, the public can come in and buy some of the things that the people who are incarcerated make. And then the money goes to support their families. So everybody wins by doing this. So I went in and I brought a lot of art, and then I brought all of our students back. There were 27 students, about three of them were lawyers, and they said, oh, come on, you're not serious. We're going into a prison today. I said, uh-huh. And they went in and the lawyers were weeping because it was a different model. It was a model that really worked. And everybody went into the shop and they bought statues from the prisoners. They brought wooden carvings. They brought hammocks to take back home to the United States. So everybody helps everybody else. And how did it help me? Because it opened my heart to other ways of doing things. Right now it's in the, you know, this particular instance was in the penal system.
And their penal system there is probably harsher than ours, and many people may have been caught up in it. So they really appreciate your help, and you were able to help their families and help their community.
Yes, and they were stunned that people from the United States would be interested in them. We were wildly interested in them because everything was being done differently. You know, one of the things in the penal system in the United States is there's so much pent-up energy. Men are separated from their wives, women from husbands. They have a motel on the at the facility, and for a dollar, you can meet your husband, your wife, your kids. So they keep it going like a village. It just blew open our hearts, and we could help them by buying from them and helping to support their families.
And it wouldn't just help the prisoners; it would also help their families and help
absolutely.
Their-
and it would and give them yeah.
And if someone did not want to visit a prison, they could help perhaps at a school, perhaps at a church, perhaps to buy things from the local people who are producing things or harvesting something as well, and inject some money into their economy.
Into their economy. The first thing you can do wherever you are traveling, if you're out of this country, go to a local crafts market. That's a very good place to start, because they're selling all of the things that indigenous people and local people make. And besides buying, you're going to have contact with people. You know, I want to talk to you about a different way of traveling that lets this all happen. But you're going to have contact directly with people. And they'll tell you that they have a cooperative, for example, where the women are selling embroidery and the men are making shoes, whatever. So not only when you buy directly from them, does your money go to them and to help them, because many of them are at a subsistence level, but also you'll find out, hey, is there an organization where I could come and see you? Can I help? And when you're on the ground, if you're traveling in a way that's not just consumerist travel, that your only goal in traveling isn't to stay in the best hotel and make sure you're eating in all of the best restaurants, but to really engage with the people. It's a very, very different kind of experience for you. And almost everywhere you go, you'll go into a library. There are expat communities all over the world. So whatever country you're in, one of the places where people meet is a library. You'll quickly find out where the expats meet. And you go there and they'll tell you about organizations that need help, where you can volunteer your time, your energy, legal expertise. It may be useful, but they have different legal systems out of the country. But you can help by teaching other skills, by just participating in the economy. But you have to travel in a way that leaves room and time for this.
And you could explore with the help of the internet, and you could try to contact these organizations ahead of time to find a way where your skills, or perhaps just a very few dollars, because a dollar, you know, $10 might go a long way abroad.
Yes. Yeah.
You can help to bolster the people, bolster the economy.
Yes.
You can to help in person. Perhaps you can teach something or do some heavy lifting, you know, for them, or to start that yes. the wheels of commerce going and continue it after you've returned to the United States.
Absolutely. So one of the things you can do wherever you live now in the United States, you can contact churches, synagogues, religious groups very often have in place a robust way of participating and helping people. That's a very good place to start. The other thing, you're all savvy, you're educated, you know your way around the internet. Let's say whatever country you're going to, look up on Facebook, look up and see if there's an expat community from that place. And bingo, you're going to be right in the location. They're going to be telling you about what's going on, and you can ask questions. Hey, I have this background. It's not only your legal background. You will have many skills, interests, hobbies. You'll connect with people, and they will give you on-the-ground information about how to get connected. And I can guarantee you, as a travel journalist for 20-plus years, when you come back from a trip like that, where the focus of the trip, of course you want to see the great sights, but when you engage with the people, you will come back and your whole feeling about the country will change, and their feeling about your country will change. You become a kind of ambassador for your country because, hey, look what Americans are like. They're not coming to rip us. They're coming to help us.
And this is going to be a trip with impact, with lasting impact.
It will have the first place it will have impact is on your heart. And that's the most important organ. It's going to touch you. It's going to move you. Everybody can see the sights. You're going to see them too. But this is something that personally enriches your life and makes you feel useful being on the planet.
Okay. And I just want to mention that we're talking with Judith Fine. As you've heard, she's a cultural adventurer, and she's also the author of the book, Life is a Trip. She's talked about some ways lawyers and others can have a trip with long-lasting benefits and a very unique cultural and charitable experience by helping people who are less fortunate abroad. What are some of the other skills that where a local community, a skills program or a school or a college might be able to use help from visiting tourists?
Well, right now it's very difficult because people aren't traveling.
In general.
I think that you're going to have to expend. This is about putting forth energy. You have to expend some energy by going on the internet and looking. Each of you wants to go to a different country, or perhaps many of you want to go to the same country. But you have to do a little research. I would suggest starting on a social media site like Facebook. I'm telling you, if you connect to expats, but the mentality, Ken, it's not about helping unfortunate people. There is so much to learn from other cultures. You are having an exchange with people from another culture. It's not that we're superior, and it's not about what we want to do. It's what do they need. Sometimes, do you know what they want? They want conversation with someone from America. There's a low impact thing you can do. And you will get to meet them through the organization. I'm telling you about like the expat community, through just going. If you have, let's say you're in any country, let's say you're in Guatemala, and you have a waiter or a wait person, a woman, a man, and it's someone so friendly and trying to speak to you in a little English, you can end up, if you talk to that person, you can end up arranging after work to help them with English languages. Maybe tell them the words in English for the kind of foods they're serving. You can help all the time as long as the attitude is, what can we exchange with each other? And you're not going in with a superior attitude, because that is not well accepted. People want to meet other people. They're dying to speak English. Just by showing up and engaging, you can help them with that. And you could tell them how to say funny words, a new expression. I remember I was in Turkey, and I taught this man how to put his fingers in his ear and go, TMI, TMI, too much information. So here's this Turkish guy. He's so excited. The next time I see him, he comes up to me. He puts his fingers in his ear and he goes, MIT, MIT. I went, no, dear, that's the university. It's TMI.
Yeah, I just want to, I mean, you always have to be careful what you say and what gestures you make in another culture, because you want it taken the proper way. And maybe it's good to get a lesson about that on do's and don'ts in communicating in another culture, so you don't have any problem with anyone.
First of all, there are books on cultural appropriateness, but I want to tell you something. Like, I wouldn't touch anybody. In Asian countries, for example, you don't ever put your hand on a kid's head. There are things like that. But let's say I made a terrible, terrible mistake. I've made multiple mistakes because I don't know what it is. What's the worst that can happen? They tell you, don't do that. That's not a nice thing. And then you go on. It's not going to kill you. If you come from a good place, we're all going to make, people can make mistakes when they come to our country and they say that.
Just talking about some other aspects of it. Is it okay to go into a store or restaurant or a church or some type of school and just ask people about their story or how their commerce works or how they got to that place, their job they have, or what their town or the country needs?
It's beyond okay. It's wonderful. As long as you're not getting in the way of their work, as long as you're not in a market and there are 20 people behind you. But if it's done in an appropriate way, I have never in any country, and I have been everywhere, all over the world as a travel journalist, I have never encountered one person who didn't want to tell a story, who didn't want to open up. People want to be, think of yourself. You want people to listen to you. You want to tell your story, your hundreds of stories. So does everybody else around the world.
And you might be able to bring them, their family, their community, their country to the next level. Help them get some commerce going, to give them funds. Maybe they need a water pump in their community or a new school or new desks or something like that. You can, with a little conversation, you can start to bring them to a better place.
Yeah, but it has to come from, this is very important, Ken. It has to come from them. It's not you saying, I could come here and fix that. Never, never.
Oh, no, you begin a conversation about what they need and how they would use it and what they need the most, and to see if you can help, start the ball rolling.
I was traveling already, and I volunteered for a company it's a nonprofit, and they provide clean water to communities around the world. And people, you know, who spend 4 hours a day, the women are going with jugs trying to get water back to cook, to drink. And what I was asked to do is to go into some quite impecunious communities where they had taught them, not done it for them, taught them how to make their own wells, to manage their own sources of water, to bring water. And my job was to go and to see how were they managing with the money they had. Was their water system in place? Now, I know nothing about water systems. I don't know anything about the pipes and the tubes. But I went. I said, why not? If that's something that you need feedback about how your money is being spent at your nonprofit, I'll do it. And I went into two communities. It was such a fabulous experience. First of all, I learned about pumps and about water systems. But the other thing was the people were so happy that there was follow-up. They wanted to explain, look what we did. Look how we built this. Look how we're maintaining it. So it's a sense of pride on both sides. You are going, you're proud to be able to do some little thing to help out, but they're proud to tell you about what they've accomplished. It's got to be parity. It's got to be equals.
And a lawyer or business person, perhaps retired, perhaps want to take a sabbatical, can help to discuss, you know, some aspects of business or the legal system or culture or marketing. Yes. With them, to help them stimulate their economy.
You know, if you have...
And find other markets for their goods.
I know people in their 60s who've gone with the Peace Corps. It's completely changed their lives and the lives of the community, where their expertise has been very useful. But sometimes building houses. Sometimes they're highly accomplished, trained professionals, and they're building houses. Or they're going into schools and helping with English. But if you show up and you want to help in a way where there's exchange, it's key, Ken, that it not be us coming, help them, poor people. It's about having an exchange with another culture where everybody feels good. And if you give them something, it's something they want, something they can use.
Right. So you want to begin to explore what they can use, whether it's knowledge, whether it's funding, whether it's a water line, or a better school, or teachers, or something along those lines.
I'll give you an example. I was recently in the city of Puebla in Mexico, and they have a fabulous market, a Christmas market. And at the Christmas market, I met these people. It was a cooperative of women, and they make fabulous embroidered shoes. And I just looked at them, and they're like $50 a pop, and they're selling in New York for $200 a pop. And they said, oh, we've talked to them. First, I didn't come in and say, I want to help you. We started to talk back and forth. They said they'd love to expand their market in the United States. Well, obviously, they're in the New York market. They're selling for $200. People want them. So you can ask, hey, maybe I can bring that to Chicago, or maybe I could bring that to wherever. You know, how would that work? How would you want to collaborate? The word collaborate. How would you want to collaborate so that we could bring this wonderful thing you have to different places in the United States? So it's a conversation, but people are very, very sensitive to coming in and trying to fix them. They're not broken. They just have certain skills, and we have certain skills. And how do you find a middle ground where you can
And you might be able to expand their markets or act as a conduit to help
Absolutely.
Import their goods, or to give them some seed money or a microloan.
Absolutely.
I just want to remind the listeners, we're talking with Judith Fine. She's a cultural adventurer, and she's the author of Your Life is a Trip.
No, Life is a Trip.
Life is a Trip. And just tell us a little bit more about some of the other topics in your book.
Well, in my book, there is what I talked to you about what I experienced exactly in a Mexican prison system. But here's what's been happening. I wrote this book some years ago, and it's become a classic in the travel genre. And people are contacting me because they're moved by some of the stories about individual people. I never expect this to happen in the book. And what I notice now, during the pandemic, people are hurting so badly economically.
Keep talking. Go ahead.
People are hurting so badly economically, especially Mexico, Guatemala, where I have a lot of connections. People are contacting me through my website. I'll give you the website. And they're telling me, this and this story really touched me. How can I bring something or help the people there? Well, for the last 7 months, I've been sending money every month to some of these people. And now other people, readers, they want to participate. I can put them in touch with the other people. And they can send money. Money right now is necessary. You know, just to get a COVID test, people don't have the money even for the test, and they don't have money to eat. And I'll send money, and you'll see, you get back a little video on WhatsApp about the food that their family bought, so the food that they can eat. This is necessary now. And I never thought my book could be a conduit, but readers are helping people in the book, and everybody is benefiting. And it makes America look good. It makes the donors look good. And it brings people, not something we think that what they need. They need food right now. They need medicine right now. They're really hurting.
So I just want to remind our listeners that Judith Fine is the author of the book, Life is a Trip. You're listening to Law You Should Know here on 90.3 WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College in Garden City, New York. Judith, what are the other books that you've written?
I wrote another book called The Spoon from Minkowitz. And it's about my going to the land where my ancestors came from. To them, it was Russia. I grew up in New York. But to them, they came from Russia. Today, it's Ukraine. And I was obsessed with this from the time I was a child. My grandmother has an accent. Where is she from? But they didn't want to talk about it. Immigrants who came to this country very often, I'm sure it's happened to many of you listening. They didn't want to tell you anything because they wanted to leave the bad things behind and raise their kids to be American. And now everybody wants to know, where do I come from? So I went on a trip to the place, to the tiny, tiny village where they came from. And I wrote this book about my story, but it's your story, about why it is essential to go to the land of your ancestors, to walk the ground they walked on, to breathe the air they breathe, to eat the food. The food is still there. And of course, when you go there, if you have a big heart, a lot of these places, again, they could benefit so greatly from the kind of things that you can offer, from English conversation, from help, from money. So the book is called
And people are interested in telling their story and perhaps hearing your story and just hearing about the rest of the world and conversing in English.
Yes. And you know, it's very interesting. In many places in the world, if you travel, you're going to find out, wow, how did you learn English? Did you learn it in school? And they'll say to you, American movies, American music. They listen to the songs. They know all the music. They know every film that comes out. They know all the movies. They can't say three words of English, but they'll say to you, Leonardo DiCaprio. You know, they love the movie star. They love American culture. And we know so little about their culture. So I don't necessarily think the way to learn before you travel is by doing research. It's you hit the ground and you start talking to people and you're going to find out the history, the culture. You'll find out business. You're interested in law, you'll find out about
the
legal.
I think it's good. It's also possible you want to have a starting point, perhaps a local guide who can meet your needs, depending on, you know, where you're going.
Absolutely.
And how extensive people might speak English there. Maybe have some cultural institutions as a focus or a starting point.
I always find, Ken, that if you go lately, for the last few years, my husband and I have changed the way we travel. We go and we rent a place and stay in a place for 2 weeks, a month, something like that, so that we're involved in the life of that place. We used to go from one place to another. I'm a travel journalist. I've been everywhere. We don't do that anymore. We go to a place and we fan out. We try to take public transportation. That's where you meet people. And we take the trains, the buses. And when you talk to anybody, it can be in a market where you're shopping. It could be walking out. It could be a local guide, because local guides are hanging around all the sites, all of them, wherever you go. Or like you said, you can arrange to have a guide beforehand, an English speaking guide. But English is not usually the problem. There are many places in the world where people do not speak English. There's always someone who shows up. Maybe in school you learn French. So you kind of brush off your old French or the Spanish that you learned when you were in high school. There is always a way to communicate if you want.
And you can also ask the local people you meet for recommendations. What is an interesting store or a market or a church or a library? Go off the beaten path, you know, and people, as you said, are interested in exchanging ideas, hearing about the rest of the world, maybe sharing their aspirations and goals with you.
Completely. And this is a big thing. I write about this in the book, Life is a Trip, that never, never disparage anyone's goals. This is a little business story, but I was in Guatemala with a Mayan woman, and she's a weaver. She comes from a village where everybody's a weaver, and they're known all over the world, but they have nothing, nothing. And when I went into her house to buy maybe a handbag or something, she took me to show her kitchen. Her kitchen was three stones with a ceramic plate on top that was used as a griddle. She had nothing. And when I walked out of her house, she tapped me on the shoulder and she said to me, "I want to do with what you do. I want to do what you do." And I thought, you want to be a travel journalist? I don't get it. She said, "I want to do what you do." And I smiled and I said, "Yes, dear, yes, you know, good luck." She said, "Yo quiero viajar. I want to travel. I want to travel." I said, "Well, great." And she asked me for my card. I gave her my card and she started contacting me. How did she do it? I don't know. This woman figured out how to travel. She now comes to the United States and she goes and she demonstrates weaving and craft shows and she's traveling. She figured out how to do it.
And you also might be able to reciprocate. Maybe someone or their children or their relative or the neighbor will come here and you can act as a guide for them.
Yes. Absolutely, 100%. When people read my books, I've written other books. I blog for Psychology Today. I write for a lot of different places. People contact me, and they want to go and meet those people. They want to have those experiences. I'm happy to help. You know, what can I tell you?
Just give us your contact information again.
The best way to contact me, I have a website. There are two different addresses for it. One is easy to remember. Live to leave, three words. L-I-V-E-T-O, leave, L-E-A-V-E. And the other word is global adventure. It's singular, globaladventure.us, like United States. So it's live to leave or globaladventure.us. And all of my books, if you go to my website, there's connection.
And what is going to be your next adventure, your next cultural adventure after, let's say, after COVID?
I want to tell you the truth. We have not stopped during COVID. We do it 100% safely, and we've never taken a plane. We figured out, we live in New Mexico. I thought I knew everything. For 7 months, we have been taking day trips around northern New Mexico. There are many other cultures here. There's a Hispanic culture that goes very, very, very deep. There's a Native American culture. We have been doing day trips. And these things that I'm telling you about in other countries, you can do it. It's probably going to be an easy car trip of an hour or two from right where you live. So, Ken, it's a way of living. It's a way of interacting with other people. If you're standing online someplace and you see someone with a turban, instead of saying to, "Oh, there's someone with a turban," you say, "May I ask you why you wear a turban?" They would love to tell you. You can have a cultural adventure every time you leave your house. That's
I think
it.
You always have to be careful where you are and where you say that. But many areas have local stores selling interesting
yes.
goods or interesting produce
yes.
or interesting goods made abroad. And it could be interesting to start a cultural conversation
yes.
and a local cultural
yes.
adventure by going in one of those stores, asking about the products, you know, maybe, you know, buying something there. They would make unique gifts.
How about you go to a Chinese restaurant? Did you ever ask the wait person where they come from in China? Or you go to a Thai restaurant or Indian restaurant. Did you ever ask them where they
and
come from?
And I agree.
From
I've done that and people are very interested and that can begin the conversation. I wish we had some more time, but I'd like to thank Judith Fine, the author of Life is a Trip, for being our guest today on Law You Should Know. If you've missed any portion of the program, you want to tell someone about it, the podcast is available at nccradio.org. And please join us this same time next week on 90.3 WHBC, the voice of Nassau Community College, for another program on Law You Should Know.